I would like to introduce you to my moderator, one of my very favorite entertainment bloggers. We have Emily Longaretta of HollywoodLife.com. Woo!
And I would like to introduce our next panelist. She is an independent casting director and casting associate of Daredevil, Luke Cage, and Stranger Things, Bess Fifer.
I've been a performer basically my whole life and started really looking for how do I fit into this vast business of entertainment. And I took an aptitude test. I was in graduate school in a small town in Alabama, and I took a 750 question aptitude test, the kind of thing that like you pay like $80 for, and it takes like 4 hours to fill out. But I was kind of desperate because I was like, okay, I can't be a PT. This is obviously really wrong for me, but I don't really know where I fit. I don't want to continue to, I don't want to make my life as a performer. I knew that for me, that was not right. Some of our actors from the last panel had a great, I think it was Tanya who had the amazing point of, you have to really need to do this to be an actor. I think in New York City, in LA, to make your living, you can't not do it, right? If there is that hesitation of like, maybe this could be for me or maybe this could be for me, with acting, you really have to, it has to be almost like a desperate passion for you. And I knew I didn't have that, but I knew I wanted to be involved. So I took this test. And among other things, like For a Stranger, casting director came up. And I didn't know a lot about the job. I understood that, yes, films get cast and there is this person, but I didn't know what the job entailed. And the more that I researched and I heard good things and bad things, my fiancé at the time had spent some time in LA, and all of his friends were convinced that casting directors were the worst people on the planet. And why would you want to be a casting director? Because they're horrible and they're mean and they're the worst. But the job description, as I kind of in my ignorance came to know it, was I get to work with actors every day and people pay me for my opinion, and I have lots of those and I can do this. So I made the decision to move to New York, had about $200 in our collective pockets of me and my fiance, and just did whatever it took to get my foot into the business. So I interned at an agency and then was her assistant, and that was not, I knew that wasn't the right path for me. I'm much more of a buyer versus a seller in the buyer-seller's market. And so I just really felt that casting was more of my passion, and so I just waited and weaseled my way into an internship at a casting office called Telsey & Company. Then it was called Bernard Telsey Casting, and basically just continued to annoy them until they let me do casting and let me do more casting, and I was able to work on commercials, which is actually where I initially met Mr. Jeffrey Cantor, and was able to work on features and music, musicals, theater, kind of got the overall. And then in about 2010, I decided that I kind of wanted a little bit more control over my life and maybe actually have a lunch break every once in a while, and went out as a freelance casting director. And so that's what I've been doing since 2010. And that means I cast my own independent films and I'm slowly building up, you know, my business as my own casting director, doing my own projects. I have some great things coming out this year, hopefully, and working as a casting associate on some very wonderful high-budget projects that I've been very fortunate to work on. And that's kind of how I ended up here. I work a lot, since going as a freelance casting director, I work a lot more like an actor, because I go job to job, and I am that person now who, even when I have a job, is looking for my next job. And so that is something that I think as an actor or even, you know, as a director, and there are varying other careers, it is that constant pursuit of what is my next gig. At first, I thought it was insane that somebody who is currently in a Broadway show would be auditioning for other Broadway shows. Like, why would you do that? You have a job. Yeah, but you don't know when that job is going to end. You don't know if you suddenly became the wrong type and they want to go a different direction. You know, there is not a whole lot of job security. Sometimes you get really lucky and you can be in a show that, you know, is on running for 20 years, but for the majority of us, those jobs are going to come to an end, and if you would like to keep working, you need to find another one.
Obviously, we determine there are a good amount of actors in the room. Obviously, it depends per role, but is there something when you are meeting with actors that are hopeful to land a role, is there something that is kind of a red flag for you that you don't, that you kind of tell people to avoid? And then what is the kind of things you are looking for quality-wise?
If you are fortunate enough to find a way to spend some time in, if you're an actor, spend some time in a casting office, whether volunteering your services as a reader or as an intern or, you know, maybe even taking assistant work, because the easiest answer to that question, I think, is it becomes obvious of just like little mistakes that people make. You know, the idea of, as humans, we're actually supposed to take ourselves down a notch when we present ourselves to other people. Like, you look lovely. Oh gosh, you know, I had this on yesterday. You know, and as actors, especially, I think it's important to keep in mind that yes, you're there to do your craft and your art, but ultimately, it's a job interview. And you're coming in to discuss and show to me, can you do this job? And aside from the creativity of can you embody and be truthful in this role, are you going to be a good person to work with? And that starts in the audition. You know, you're not going to show up at Google for your job interview and not know what Google does. So I think it's, again, expanding on what the wonderful actors said before, people have tones. Both casting directors, people who have multiple shows, they have a tone. You can see, do they like authentic-looking people? Are they going for more of a look that's a shinier, glossier, you know, attractive people feel? Are you really trying to find people who are looking for the Midwest? And then you can go deeper into that of, like, what, not just what the casting director responds to, but what do the people who they work for then respond to? So then you get into the directors and the writers and doing your research. And adding on to that, networks often have a tone, and you should know what network your show is going to be on. CBS procedurals have a tone. If you're going in for a CBS show, you should know what they like on their network. Lifetime definitely has a tone. Nickelodeon has a tone, and it's different from Disney. You need to know the difference in how they like their comedy delivered. Those are things you can find. Fox comedies have a different tone from, say, an NBC comedy. The way TBS is going with their current scripted television. AMC is another big one that they have started creating content based on their viewership. And there are things that you can learn from paying attention to that, right? Doing the research of the person that you're going in to meet, doing the research of the person you're ultimately reading for. So I think the biggest thing for me, getting back to your original question, is walking in ready to go. There's so many times you walk in and apology is the first thing that comes out of your mouth. I'm sorry the train was delayed. I'm sorry I just got this last night. I'm sorry my hair is a mess. I'm sorry. Like, just why? And that's, as humans, we do that all the time. We're just like constantly apologizing. In the audition room and in a job interview, when you come in and apologize, it's basically like saying, I'm not at my best today, but here we go. So be your best. And if there is something that you feel the need to say, say it at the end. I'm sorry I was a few minutes late. You know, that's the courtesy at the end instead of starting with that. I just need to be I know you want me to be here, but I'm here today. Right? It's just put your best foot forward and don't shoot yourself in the foot by coming in and apologizing.
Great. So obviously, Stranger Things, Daredevil, those are both Netflix, which is obviously a whole new network in a way. So when it comes to that, how did you get into that, and what did you kind of look for when people were trying out for those parts versus trying out for network TV and movies?
It's all a little different, and even the TV shows that I've worked on have all fallen under Netflix as a distributor, but their parent companies are different. Daredevil and Luke Cage are Marvel and ABC Touchstone. So they have their own kind of ways that they like to do things. Marvel is notoriously secretive. So generally, when we would get a script, we would then have to basically wash out any pertinent info that could actually tell you what the story was about, and then give those to the actors. So as casting, it was difficult because we couldn't actually say what we were looking for. We couldn't just say, we need this construction worker. We had to say, we need a physically strong male blue collar. And so it limits you from being as specific as you could be to try and avoid things that aren't right. And so that has its kind of its own troubles. So for that, I think it was really about, and I worked for an amazing casting director, casting team, Julie Schubert and Lorraine Mayfield, who do all of the Marvel TV shows right now. And they are just so wonderful in their knowledge of actors, but because the breakdown system, which is how we post our breakdowns and talk to agents and have submissions on actors who were right and who we could bring in to see, we couldn't rely on that because we couldn't actually give out the information that was going to get us that information. So a lot of it was lists of actors in New York that we knew and we loved who were going to fit the roles that we knew exactly what we needed but couldn't advertise for what we needed. Stranger Things was a little different because it was the first time that Netflix was actually acting as their production and parent company. The major difference with Stranger Things as casting a series is because the leads of the show are children. And so the casting process for those kids was extensive. The sessions, the auditions, the work sessions that we did with those kids were 10 times more extensive and harder than even some of the most major adult auditions that I've ever done. Those kids worked their tails off getting the material and they could all read multiple times. Every time they came in, it was a new set of material. If you've seen the show, it's, you know, describing to 11-year-old boys who actually don't know what Dungeons and Dragons are and having to then say, no, actually, you have to tell this story and you need to be the Demogorgon and be like coming towards me and trying to scare your friends. So it was a lot of a different kind of set of like, how do we get this feeling and how do we get these kids to feel authentic from the 80s when these kids are used to the things that we never even imagined were available back then.
So then when it comes into bringing in Winona Ryder and bringing in David Harbour and these people who are experts, is that just kind of much more relaxing on your guys' front in a way?
Well, Winona Ryder was somebody who came kind of on board and was attached. Varying projects and varying budgets of projects and varying, you know, depending on what the stage of the project is in when it comes to the casting director. Sometimes you can have a certain number of people attached already, or you're starting from scratch. A lot of times with independent film, I'm starting from scratch, there's nobody attached on board, and that's actually the hardest way to do it, because starting from nothing, it's always the hardest thing is getting the first person on board. And once you have that first person on board, they set the tone for the whole rest of the casting process and, you know, really help kick it off. So they were basically in talks with her when we got started. But David Harbour, he did come in, he read, and he knocked it out of the park.
So now working on indies and things that really under your control in a way, is that something that you suggest a lot of actors starting out try and do as well? They try and come in and read for that to get that experience and really, because obviously the writing is still amazing, a lot of those movies end up becoming huge as well.
I think the important thing for actors getting started in the business, and especially in New York, is to work, is to create art. Because for me, it's hard for me. My process and the process of casting anything is dependent on the budget and how much they can actually afford for me to do. If they can afford for me to search outside of New York, I'm going to search outside of New York and try and find, you know, the best person for the job. I have to see you. In order for me to bring you in for the first time, I really need to already know something about you. Now, whether it's you have a reel, you've done a short film, you had a play that you invited me to, you were a part of, you know, of a class that I did in which I was able to see your work. Because I'm not given a lot of time to explore people that I don't know. Because I am constrained by the budget. And so if I have 4 weeks to cast 65 speaking roles, there is a finite number of people that I can see for each of those roles. And the smaller the role, the less people I'm actually going to be able to see, because I'm going to need to see 50 people, you know, for these larger roles. And so when it gets down to the under five or the one lines, I got to bring in those people who I know, if I can only see five of them, all five of them have a really great chance for getting this role. Because ultimately, my job is to fill in all the holes and have a complete cast. So if I can't take a chance on you, there has to be a way for me to see your work. So you need to find a way to work. And that's where creating your own content comes in. Writing skits, writing web series with your friends and shooting them. Even if they're rough quality, if your performances are great, that is helpful to me. Student films. We have a lot of great film schools in New York City. They all have to do thesis films. Knowing how, where to look, because that filmmaker that is coming out of NYU is going to be the next decade's festival winners. And if you start building those relationships now, they're going to benefit you later on. But I think the most important thing is to work and then be able to have some sort of income coming in to let you continue working without the work being dependent on you making the money. Until you have something that you can really showcase and say, this is what I can do. Let me show you what else I can do.
What is, when you're casting a stage production versus TV and film, what is the difference between what you're looking for there and the experience that they need to have?
Yeah. The audition experience is incredibly different. And I think stage acting and on-camera acting is also incredibly different, simply for the reason that when you are on stage, you are generally always it shown in full body. And the audience is away from you, and we're seeing you, and we're seeing the set, and we're seeing everyone else that's in there. And so as a result, when you act, your acting also has to be a little bit more of an extension of your body, right? You need to create a little bit more physical emotion than you do when there's a camera in your face. When you are actually on set and shooting, you can have a variety of framings. It could be a very long, like wide frame where we're seeing scenery and two actors walking through the park. It could be, you know, I'm just looking, seeing you full head to toe. It could be I'm seeing you from the knee up. It could be that we're right in your face and we're watching you cry, right? In an audition, generally, it's always the same, and it's going to be your head and your shoulders. And that's all. And the reason for that is I need to take your tape that I create in the room and I need to send it to the directors and the producers, and they need to be as close to you as possible to see what you can do. It doesn't help them if they're in California and they're seeing the entire couch while we're playing this scene. It doesn't help them be close to you and get to know what you can really do. So it's my job to show them as close as possible what you can do. So from an audition standpoint, a theater audition is more like theater acting. It's going to be more full-bodied. You're going to take up space. You might move a little bit. And your on-camera audition is anything that's not within this head and shoulder frames does not exist in your performance. Nobody is seeing it. So if you're being really emphatic with your arms, it's not helping you, and it's actually wasting energy. So for me, the hugest difference is when you have to do an on-camera audition, what you could normally use your full body for, you have to convey in your face and your head and your shoulders. And it becomes more of a think, don't act, because if you start to act, it's already too broad. But if you start the thought process, you get just enough of that reaction for it to feel real within this head and shoulder space, if that makes sense. On-camera acting has to do with knowing the size of your frame and filling that frame and not overfilling the frame. So in theater, your frame stays the same. Set may change, but it's always a wide frame. And when you're doing TV and film, it could be a multitude of frames. And as an actor, you need to know what your framing is to know how much of yourself you can use to convey your message.
It's really interesting. You'd never think about it if you're not doing it. Okay. So, is there a story that you could share, even about a specific time that you had an audition that really sticks out in your mind? You don't have to say who, but just something that an actor did that really blew you away in an audition.
Like in a good way or in a bad way?
Either way. Just something memorable.
I'll give you like a good one and a bad one. The great one was, I often, when I'm doing auditions, I will read with the actors. Kind of to help try and push tone or push just the tempo. But also so that it's really just a very comfortable, safe environment where it's just me and the actor and then a camera, and there's not really anyone else involved. Cara Buono plays Mrs. Wheeler on Stranger Things, and her audition, it was one of the scenes between her and her daughter Nancy, and it was a little different the way it was originally written, but by the end of her audition, we were both crying. Essentially just because we had just read this scene and it just was both of us so emotionally connected to what was happening that like we're both at the end like wiping our eyes. And that's, you know, sometimes that happens and it's authentic and it's just not normally that like I'm actually involved and like we're both crying together and making each other cry. So that was, I think that was like, and she had, you know, got the job. So that's amazing. Awkwardly, I was reading with, I guess, a very prominent actor who had come in to audition for something. He was currently in a Broadway play, and it made sense to him in his head that the character he was reading for should wear a cape. So he wore the cape. I mean, it wasn't wrong, per se, but it was an interesting choice. And when we were reading, and he did an excellent audition, I will say, the audition and actually what came out on camera was beautiful, which is generally what I care about. It's what ends up on tape is what I care about. What you couldn't see, though, was that he had decided that he was taping his lines to my knee. And he didn't even ask. He was just like, I'm going to have to just tape this right here. And he was just like, and then all of his sides were like across my kneecaps. And it was probably like about like 7 or 8 years ago. So I was like younger and a little like less confident in my career. And like I was already kind of, you know, directing somebody who I grew up watching on TV and film and was just kind of like, okay, wow, this is interesting. And now he's taping his sides to my knee.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
My last question before I get to audience questions is a piece of advice that you would give yourself now when you were younger looking back.
That people who were awkward as children are a heck of a lot more interesting as adults.
It's a good one. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that a lot. All right, guys, I want to make sure I open it up. So if anyone has questions, if you just want to raise your hand, I think there's someone with a mic.
Who's got questions?
I'm a Taurus. What?
Gentleman in the hat. For callbacks, I know you guys see tapes all the time. And when you get the tape, you're like, oh, I love that guy. I want him to come and see me. So when he comes to see you, or when the person comes to see you, what are you expecting? The same thing on the tape? Something different? What are you expecting?
Well, if you submitted a tape, like it's you did a self-tape at first, and right. The person wants to meet you, they saw something interesting in your tape, something that makes them think that you could solve their problem. Because for me, when I start a project, I have 60 problems or 35 problems, right? And that's my job, is to solve these problems. So if I'm calling you in from a callback off of a tape, I think you might be an option to solving my problem. And I want to see if we can get you to the point where it's an excellent fit or an even better fit than what we thought was going to be written together. So it's an opportunity. And I think when you've done that tape and you're, what do I do differently in the callback, is you come in prepared to do what you did, but with an open mind and an ear enough to listen to what this person is offering you as a suggestion. Because what my job is to try and not tell you what to do. You know, as a casting director, I am not the director of the film, but I also have information that you might not have. So I'm gonna take what you brought to the table and see if we can make it cohesive and fit and solve this problem that we have here. And sometimes it does, and sometimes it doesn't. And when it doesn't, I'm disappointed, and you're disappointed. And when it does, it's magic.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, I'm good.
I'm Jordan. So I have just a quick question. So it was established already that for actors, it is important once you receive an audition to have some idea of the tone of the show. And a lot of times you'll get an audition and you've never watched a show before, and you have 2 days to kind of make choices and figure that out. I'm curious, from your perspective, as a freelance casting director, if you're ever put in a similar situation, where you know, how much time do you have to prepare yourself for the casting and understanding of that project? And whether it's a pitch from you to the director and to show that you understand the tone of this project, and you know what that process is for you.
Yeah, I mean, I have job interviews as well. You know, I met with a director yesterday about a project that he was doing to see if we have the same fit. One thing that I was wrong about when I thought that my job was going to be all about working with actors and getting to tell my opinion is it actually isn't always my opinion that matters. It's the director and the producer's opinion. So me having good taste is great. I've learned I do have good taste when it comes to actors, but more importantly, I have to understand what my director's taste is and what they want. I've been very lucky. There has only been, you know, a couple of directors that at the end of the day I was like, yeah, I'm not getting what you're going for with this, or I don't get why you like these people that you're liking, because it doesn't seem like it's, you know, lining up with the way the story is built. But ultimately, it's my job to feel out what the writer and the director are intending and what they're wanting to go for. I think to add on what you were saying originally about seeing the show and trying to get out that vibe, and if you have it, you know, 24 hours to prepare, really digging into sides material and script preparation, I think that especially with a short amount of time, is what is the purpose of my character? Is my character just there to, like, distract for a moment, a la people are talking, and the doorbell rings, and it's the pizza guy, and he says, here's your pizza, and then you drop your pizza, and then they go back to doing what they're doing. It's a distraction. You know that? Does it matter so much about the tone of the show? No, it matters that you know what the purpose of your character is, which is to not to say he's the guy who had a really bad day and hates his job. He's the guy who comes and he delivers the pizza. Knowing if your character is supposed to be an antagonist, knowing if your character is supposed to be the person who's delivering a bunch of material, like information, you know, especially with procedurals, you have the medical examiner guy who comes in and basically tells you everything that happened to the poor victim so that the guys can go. So as the medical examiner and coming in for that audition, your job is to know and sound like all of that medical jargon coming out of your mouth actually makes sense to you. Right? So it's finding what is the what's the catalyst, what's the job of my character. Pilot season is coming up. If hopefully some of you will be able to be a part of that process. One of the big things of auditioning for a pilot and auditioning for those series regular roles is what is the role, what is the job of my character in this series? What are they going to be? Are they the headbutting love interest? Are they the, you know, the smart one who actually really knows what's going on? Every setup to a show, people have their responsibilities, and you will have a much better audition if you can figure out what your character is supposed to be doing, what their purpose is, giving information, moving a scene along, being a distraction. That kind of thing.
All right, great. We have time for one more question. Gentleman in the back.
Hi, how's it going? We talked earlier about like actors writing their own stuff and kind of taking on more roles with, you know, the collaborative effort with doing work. And then what comes to mind is casting directors like Megan Rafferty. She acts as well. And do you ever think about kind of taking on a new role job for the production or where casting directors could evolve in, you know, maybe taking on or producing your own things or writing or stuff like that?
I have done two professional acting jobs in my life. Both times I was basically playing myself, so it wasn't really a lot of heavy acting. I for casting directors, most of us are very, very happy staying behind the table. It's where we're the most comfortable. I do know that a lot of people are getting more into producing. In the past, sometimes that's come for, and the producing credits that I have come from, well, we can't pay you this much, so we'll give you some producer credits. So it's actually more of like a back-end kind of compensation. But there are several casting directors. Katya Blickfield is one who, her and her husband, Ben Sinclair, she was a casting director on 30 Rock, and now she's a producer, writer, creator of High Maintenance. So I think it's, in any of us, we all have the potential to kind of create and move along and move outside. I would have to ask Megan how she makes that work for her, because it's not necessarily like, you know, it would be a little odd if she's like doing a TV series and then she's putting herself on tape for the roles. That being said, I auditioned several times for Daredevil and was on hold for like a heavy recurring, and the whole time I was going, please don't let me get this job because I don't really want to do this job. But my boss made me do it because she was like, you're right, and I need to cast this role, and we're having a hard time and you're going on tape. But that's not my choice, and I prayed every day. And the other thing was like, I'm happy doing what I do. I love being in the audition room with an actor and finding something that is just really clicks it in. Jeffrey Cantor can tell you the part of his Daredevil audition that he didn't tell you was that I kind of beat the crap out of him. Every time we did it, something new came out of what we were reading that was exciting to both of us so that we would do it again to keep going, because there was constantly something. Jeffrey and I know each other very well that I felt comfortably like really kind of beating him up and he felt comfortable taking it. But it was, okay, let's try this. Okay, now that didn't work, so let's go back to this way and try this again. You always, I'm expecting it. Do you want a microphone?
So it wasn't really beating me up, right? So what she thinks is beating me up is me thinking, oh, wow, somebody's playing with me. So also realized I was in pain and on a lot of drugs because I had a broken shoulder. But the fact of the matter was that we have known each other for a long time. And so I didn't feel abused. Rather, I felt encouraged. And how often, every audition for an actor is a chance to do your work, right? So the audition is another opportunity for you to do your job. Whether you're in the room in front of the camera or whether you're auditioning for somebody who wants you to get the part, it's another opportunity to play. And when you have somebody who's being a director, not a casting director, a director, that's what she was doing, all of a sudden, that 40 minutes or whatever, however long we were in the room, goes by like that, and you had a great time, and whether you get the part or not, you had 40 minutes or however long it was of a great experience as an actor. It's a win. You don't lose. There's no lose, right? But so I didn't feel beaten up. I felt encouraged, and I got the part. and wasn't there a medical examiner, too? Yeah, so the medical examiner that she's referring to. Thank you.
I think that's a great note to end it on. Thank you so much for coming in. I really, really appreciate it, and I think everyone here really appreciates it.
Give it up one more time for Bess Fifer, and thank you to Emily Longaretta.